Welcome to the Field of 68, our Off the Carousel series, a series where we go every season, every off season for coaches, first-year coaches at their new location. And today we have no one else than the man, Brooks Savage at ETSU, comes from Wake Forest. Brooks, first of all, welcome and congratulations on the new gig.
Thanks, T.O. Great to be here, man. Before we were trying to get on here, you know, we had a little technical difficulty. I told you, you Clemson grads. My sister's a Clemson grad, but you know, there's a reason why it was my safety school. You guys aren't overly bright over there.
It takes us a minute to figure out some of these Zoom contacts. That's a fact. But moving on to ETSU, back to Johnson City. I mean, you've had experience there. You worked for Steve Forbes there at ETSU. Followed him to Wake Forest. When this one came up back in Johnson City, what drew you back to the tri-state area?
Yeah, the Tri-Cities. I mean, there's so many great things about this place, T.O., and you're familiar with this part of the country. They love basketball here in Johnson City and Northeast Tennessee. They love the Bucks. We got great facilities. We got unbelievable support. We got the best fans in the Southern Conference, lead the league in attendance year in, year out. And then just the type of life-changing place that this can be for our guys. I know it was for me and for our staff and our program the last time. And so obviously a place I'm really familiar with, top-down alignment from Dr. Brian Nolan, our president, who plays basketball in the student center with the students every Sunday night. And then Dr. Richard Sander, our AD, who's the best there is. And so just the people, the place, the tradition, and you can win big like we did before. So just all that stuff makes it a dream job destination type of place.
What was the process like for you as soon as the job came open? What was that interview process like? Obviously, a lot of ADs like to do their due diligence, but they were already familiar with you from the previous go around. What was your process like?
It was fast. I mean, you know, you get wrapped up in your own season, and we were trying to make a run there at the end of Wake Forest. But I think the job came open, and I think I got a call on a Sunday and asked if I would have interest. And of course I did, and, jumped on an interview on Monday with the committee. There were some other conversations Tuesday and Wednesday. Coach Forbes was obviously instrumental in the process of helping me get it. Just, you know, all the relationships that he has in the community and just helping, you know, build support for me. And then, it ended on Thursday with a Zoom with Dr. Nolan, and that went really well. And then you're kind of sitting by the phone because you feel like maybe you might get a call, and then it didn't on Thursday. So I'm like a nervous wreck. And then Friday, Dr. Sander called Friday morning, and I was at home with my wife, Lauren. And so we got to kind of share that together, which was cool. And then press conference the following Monday. So it was a quick process. I think they just wanted some familiarity, somebody, you know, not only myself, but our staff, who had great pride in the program and understands what it takes to win big here.
What was the first order of business? Obviously, where they go 12-20 last season, what was the first order of business to you to get ETSU back to where you feel it can be?
Yeah, right. Coming through the door right away, I was trying to connect with the guys that were still here and try to keep as many of those guys that wanted to be here.
Sure.
And wanted to be part of the solution. Like, let's go. And so that was the first important thing. That was pretty much all day Monday afternoon. And then all day Tuesday, having individual meetings, trying to get them excited. It's like, it's a race to relationship, as I've kind of called it. Like, you have a very short window to grab their attention and get them excited about the future of this program and how they're going to be a part of it and their place in it. And so it's style of play and trying to just, you know, get them fired up. And, you know, because there's a week, like there was from the time the job opens until there's a new coach, there's time that elapses. And so people are in their ear and they're wondering what's going on. And so that you got to make up for that time. And that, it's not easy to do, but I love the guys we kept. Jaden Seymour is going to be a stud for us. Justice Smith, I think, will be one of the most improved players in our league. He fits our style. Both of those guys fit our style of play perfectly. Braden Illick is a big young kid that can stretch it and has got, a really, really high ceiling. And then Alan Struthers is a guy in the backcourt that's tough, Newport News, Virginia. Dad's a coach, knows how to play. And so been really pleased with those guys this spring.
Braden Ellick, Tennessee Bobcats guy. I feel like I need to throw that out there for Kevin Feltner. Obviously, the Southern Conference has been littered with really good coaching over the past few seasons. You look, Wes Miller goes to Cincinnati. You have Steve Forbes going to Wake. You have all these different opportunities coming out of this particular league. That's obviously part of the challenge, right? What do you have to say about how you attack that? Because there is a lot of good coaches still in this league. Bob Ritchie of Furman. You got Coach Jones over at UNCG. There's a lot of really good coaching in this league.
There's exceptional coaches in this league and has been, since I've been in this league 7 years before, and there's just been great coaches everywhere. You have Ed Conroy at the Citadel. Are you kidding me? Yeah. Nobody's signing up to go in there. Greg Gary at Mercer, phenomenal coach. What Bucky is doing at Samford and getting that place excited about basketball there. So, I mean, the guys you mentioned, obviously Bob is – built that thing into a monster down in Greenville. So the league is, the league is great, and it's always had great coaches. It's always had great players. But I think just the familiarity with that and having been through those battles, but also, the ACC, we had some good coaches too. So, getting prepared for those guys night in, night out, I think helped prepare me, for this. But just an awesome basketball league. And it always has been. It's one of the oldest leagues in the country. Jerry West played in this league. Steph Curry played in this league, on down the line. So a great lineage, a great tradition of great coaches, players, and teams. And we've been making some noise in the tournament. This is a league where you can get a good seed and help your chances of winning. Furman won this year. Chattanooga lost to Illinois last year at the buzzer. Greensboro has been competitive. I think we would have had a great shot to win a game or two in 2020, in Wofford, they beat, had Kentucky on the ropes to go to the Sweet 16. So
yeah,
it's a great league and one that is very competitive.
Obviously, in today's age, the NCAA is constantly changing. You guys have had experience in bringing guys in at Wake Forest at your last stop of finding these guys that can make tremendous impacts in 1 year, 2 years. Is that something you're going to bring over to ETSU, or is it going to be a mixed bag?
We'll definitely always utilize the portal, T.O. But, we had a good mix last time. We had a number of all freshmen, players. I think that's one thing that gets lost on kind of our reputation as a staff in recruiting, is that it's just JUCO guys. It's just transfers. But, look, Bobby Klempman this year, and Cameron Hildreth, good high school players. We had Malad Narmish here last time. Bo Hodges, Davian Williamson, Damari Monsanto were all high school players here at ETSU. So it's always been a good mix. But we're going to recruit, all of it, but we'll always be active in the portal and in junior college here. But yeah, we've had great success. I think we were kind of a little bit ahead. We were kind of in the portal before it was kind of a thing. The last time here, we had a number of grad transfers and we were getting waivers for guys. I think that, allowed us to be old and competitive right away. And so, but it's changed a little bit now. But, we've had to fill nine new guys. And so we've been working at that pretty tirelessly.
You and Coach Forbes, over 300 games together. Obviously, you're your own man. What do you think you'll take from Coach Forbes more than anything else? Because he's had a good bit of success moving on to Wake Forest and doing what he's done in the ACC, and he's also had that success at ETSU. What's going to be your biggest takeaway from what he does, and what do you think you potentially would do a little bit differently?
Yeah, that's a great question. I couldn't have had a better teacher. I tell you that he was been tremendous to me. Obviously wouldn't be here without him. He's given me an enormous responsibility over the years, as he has our entire staff. And so a lot of it will look kind of the same, because I think he let us put our fingerprints on a lot of it. So, but I think there'll be some things differently that are unique to this team. You know, you always want to try to build your team to the strengths of your roster, and we'll always do that. We ran different things and played different defenses and stuff while we were here than we did from Wake Forest. And so I think you're always evolving a little bit, but I think the where we will be most similar is in just what we value, how you should run the program, what goes into winning, the types of guys to recruit. I think that's where it'll be most similar. The style of play could vary some, but what, you know, makes you win big and what goes into winning will be a lot the same.
Gotcha. And that is Brooke Savage, one of my favorite guys on the summer circuit, at least whenever I get to run into you. I'm so happy for you to get this opportunity. ETSU, you get a good one. Brooke Savage, new head coach at East Tennessee State, the Buccaneers. Coach, congratulations, and thank you for joining.
Thanks, T.O. If you got any eligibility, man, we need somebody who can make baskets over here. So I know
everybody can shoot now. I'm not special from anybody else. Anybody can shoot now.
You never lack for confidence. I know that.
Well, that's a big portion of it. Coach, thank you so much for coming on. This is Off the Carousel with the Field of 68.
Our partner for today's episode is Athletic Greens. I started taking AG1 during the college basketball season, and I loved the impact that it had on my energy levels. I'm a big coffee in the morning guy, but by the time that the afternoon would hit, I needed another boost. AG1 helped me tremendously, especially on those days when I didn't want to get up off the couch and go hit the gym. Their tagline is AG1 is comprehensive health and the power of habit in one. And man, that could not be more true. It's nearly impossible to eat and drink in a healthy manner in the month of February and the month of March when you are in my business. And AG1 was exactly the supplement that I needed to improve my gut health and cover my nutritional bases for the day. I've continued that into April. I've continued that into May, and I'm going to continue that the rest of the summer. All I have to do is mix a scoop of AG1 with some water or maybe add it into a smoothie, and I'm ready to go. Do it after lunch and you'll be ready to go for the rest of the day. If a comprehensive solution is what you need from your supplement routine, then Athletic Greens is giving you a free one-year supply of vitamin D and 5 free travel packs with your first purchase. Go to athleticgreens.com/field68. That's field68, F-I-E-L-D, the number 6, the number 8, and you can get yours now. So check it out and help support this show. Thanks.